I'm up here to introduce Dave Giltner right next to me here. He is a very interesting speaker for us to have here. He's a scientist who has his PhD from CSU, actually, in physics, and has spent a lot of time over the last couple decades working in the private sector as opposed to academia. And one of the things we are really concerned about at the School of Global Environmental Sustainability is the ability to make connections outside of the traditional disciplines of scientific sustainability. So we're very concerned about being able to connect to decision makers in the public sector, in the government, and in the private sector. So when we had the opportunity to bring Dave up here and give this talk, I was particularly excited because I saw him as a person who's really spent a lot of time at the boundaries between science and a really important sector of society. And so I think we all have a lot to learn from him about things that transfer across that boundary quite easily and the things that might be kind of challenging. So he's been working on career counseling and career development for almost a decade now, and he has a book that I will plug for you since he might not plug it himself, Turning Science into Things People Need. I encourage you all to look at that. And with no further ado, let's welcome Dave and hear what he has to say.
Thank you very much. That. Thank you everybody for coming, especially on a snowy day. It's a little slick out there. Glad you all made it. I came up and pulled a little shaky for a little while. Before I get started, I'd like to know the audience. So let's see, I see kind of a blend. Students, who are students in this? Never want to make assumptions just based on age or anything. And then thanks to everybody else. Who considers himself a scientist? Who's a scientist in this? Quite a bit of the crowd. Anybody who's not any engineers? Any engineers here? Awesome. Excellent. And then a few from other areas. And of the students, are you graduate students? Okay, any undergrads? All right, great. It helps me know my audience. Last question. Of those of you who are students, who is considering working in industry in the private sector? Anyone? Awesome. And then some people go on academic track, stay in research, okay, or maybe even the public sector, great. So the title of the talk is Implementing Research Solutions in the Private Sector, Turning Science into Things People Need, which is the title of the book, incidentally. So I want to talk about how we actually, how science is actually implemented in kind of the real world, as some people will say. So, I'll start with science has tremendous value. I don't think I have to convince anybody of that here, right? Not everybody appreciates that, but I imagine I've got a fairly captive audience in here. But what is also true is that we need people to implement the solutions, implement some kind of solutions or solve problems with the information that we gain through research, through science and research, right? And that's equally important. And that too is not necessarily appreciated by everybody, but that's a lot of what I talk about. We need somebody to actually go out and use the information that's gained in the lab or in research programs and actually solve some of the problems. And in particular, I think of the sustainability group here, many of you are working on problems that arguably are some of the most important things we really need people to solve, far more important than just technology that goes into the next iPhone or something like that, right? But I think, who better than scientists to be some of the people that go out and implement those solutions? That's not what everybody thinks of, necessarily. But in this talk, I want to make a case for scientists being great candidates to go out into the private sector and actually implement some of the solutions. Moving out from research, both have value. And that's what I want to talk about in this talk. So we all know scientists are problem solvers, obviously in a lab or in the research environment. But there's an awful lot that scientists bring outside of the research lab to the world of industry. So obviously we're smart, we like to learn new things, that's valuable in almost any setting. We have a very unique analytical approach that is actually amazingly rare out in the world of industry, even among other technical folks. I guess we didn't have too many engineers. So I'll just say, I'm really surprised that it's not trained as much in engineering as it seems to be in science, just to give a little plug for the scientists there. But seriously, scientists are trained in problem solving. There really is a unique approach in a lot of different problems, and that's something you don't find a lot outside of research, but is very valuable. We're also prone to challenging assumptions. After over 20 years in industry, you know, a lot of things can go wrong in companies. A lot of problems come from assumptions. Scientists are really good at stopping and saying, are we really sure about that? That's a lot of what research is fundamentally about, right? Stopping and thinking, are we sure that that's it? Let's go collect some data. Let's do some more analysis. And they also find the unexplained interesting. I'll talk a little bit more about that one. But these are all things that really make scientists great problem solvers, not just in a research area, but are very valuable outside of that in the private sector, actually implementing solutions, actually making things. But there's value, and part of what I want to encourage those of you who are starting your careers to consider is not just considering going out in the private sector and working in a company, but perhaps even starting your own company. A lot of people don't think of scientists necessarily as good candidates for that, but it turns out scientists can make great entrepreneurs as well. It's not what I expected, but I've heard of a number of them and talked to a number of them in the interviews that went into my book. So why? Well, first of all, scientists are great at research. If you're going to start a company, there's actually a lot of research you have to do, whether it's understanding the market, understanding competition, and just learning how do I start a company. Right? It goes well beyond just the technology that you might be studying in a research environment. There's a lot you have to research, and that's really important. Basically, scientists are learning to solve problems no one else has solved. So those of you that are graduate students, that's probably what you're doing for your thesis, right? That's generally what is required for a PhD. You're given a problem nobody else has ever solved before. It's your job to figure out how to get to that answer. Well, starting a company is actually an extreme version of that. Usually, somebody who starts a company to solve some problem says, you know what, nobody else out there is addressing this. I want to do it. I want to get out there and do that. So it's a version of this. But also, those of you who are studying problems, especially, again, look at sustainability problems that are things that really need to be addressed. Who knows those problems better than you? Once you get to to where you're defending, you know probably more about these issues than a lot of people. Who better to go out and actually try and solve them than you? So that's the case I want to make in this today. So why do I care? Why am I talking about this? Just give you a little bit more of my background so you know where I'm coming from. So as Paul said, I'm PhD in physics. I actually graduated from here. My advisor, Sue, I was up in the front row. And I was a physicist, and I worked in a laser spectroscopy lab. And we worked on really cool stuff. We actually got our photo on the front of I don't know if you guys remember this. This was the old catalog from then. It's great when you work in a laser lab. Everybody wants to put pictures of your lab up on catalogs and things because you got all these pretty colors. It's great. So this is my lab partner and I in the lab. We got on the cover. We were doing very fundamental basic research, right? There's a couple of projects I worked on, a precision test of special relativity, an atom interferometer, demonstrated the interference of matter waves. Very cool, exciting research, but also very fundamental, very far from any application. So when I decided in the last year before I defended that I wanted to go out into industry, there was a lot of questions. There was this, you know, kind of this huge unknown I was moving out into. What would I do out in industry? Private sector? What kind of jobs would I have? How do I make connections? You know, what would I do? How do I sell myself? A huge gap. Well, I managed to get over that, and after 20 some odd years, I've done a variety of things that have been very exciting, first of all. That's part of my message. Starting with pretty straightforward technology development, up through some management. I ran a field operations team at one time, and then the last several years, I've been working more in kind of technical sales types of roles. So the point is I saw a wide spectrum of business, of what it's like in industry. I've learned a lot about it, about how it works. I've also learned it's a really, really exciting option. That's part of the plug to go into as a scientist, and that absolutely, there is a lot to do. But I also learned that in many ways it's very different than academia. And so this is what I do now. This is what Turing Science is about, and this is what I've been doing full-time for about 7 months. But it started with my book about 7 years ago. I help scientists and engineers transition into the private sector, into industry, and design and build rewarding careers there. Because there really are some real differences. I like this photo. It's got a lab versus, this was a photo from one of the early products that I worked on, a catalog photo. And anybody that understands saturated absorption spectroscopy will know it's not really a perfect picture, but that's kind of the part of the thing. It's very different things that are important. And if you want to move out into the private sector, well, it's an amazing place for a career and a lot of exciting stuff. It's also important to understand how it's different than a research environment or than academia, that place that we're trained, right? So that's what I want to talk about today. Now, all this started with my book, so a lot of what I'll pull from is in this. So what I did for this, about 7 years, I had an opportunity, ran into this publisher who was doing interview books. And so because of my own story, making this transition from a really fundamental research environment out into the private sector and really enjoying that, but knowing that anyone who was still back in graduate school probably didn't know any more about it than I did, I decided to interview a lot of other scientists who had been successful in the private sector, who had had careers. Most of them are anywhere between 10, 15, I think the furthest is 35 or so years into their careers, and so they've been successful telling those stories. So I'll talk a little bit about that today. Incidentally, 5 of the scientists that are in the book actually are successful entrepreneurs and started their own company, and that's what got me thinking about scientists actually make great entrepreneurs. So that's kind of the background. But what I want to say specifically then today, what I want to share with you then is 3 stories, or stories of 3 scientists who've actually built careers in industry, just to illustrate, you know, how they were successful, what made them successful. 2 of them actually are successful entrepreneurs and started their own company to solve some problem they wanted to address. So that's the first thing. Second, then I want to talk about 3 important differences between academia and industry, just to highlight if you're interested in going out there. So this kind of makes the case for this is a great place to consider a career if that's what you're thinking about. Give you some more ideas on that. But then this is really about how do you have to start to think differently. I'll talk a little bit about some habits that you need to change when you go out into the real world. So does that sound like a good investment for this hour? If I give you that, worthwhile? Okay, great. So let's jump into it then. So the first one that I interviewed in this book, her name's Tanya Bashir. She actually got a master's in physics. She studied in Germany, Kaiserslautern, and she started her career with Siemens. So again, going from research into a company. What she found a real niche in reliability engineering and failure analysis. And this is a really interesting place she found, and this is a lot of what she told me in the interview, is this was great for somebody that had been in research because reliability engineering, so they said, well, what is that? I know when I was a student, I didn't even know what that was. But Siemens was building datacom transceivers. So things that carried, probably wasn't internet data at the time, but communications data. And these are very high reliability devices. So part of her job was to take a lot of these things and put them on tests. So she had to design experiments, collect a lot of data, to analyze the data. When things would fail, which is always going to happen, she had to dig in there and figure out why did these things fail. It turns out that actually stimulated the part of her that really enjoyed science in the first place. So that was really a great step for her, and she found a niche there. And she's pretty much done that her entire career. She's now actually working at Medtronic, so she's into medical devices, which are also very important. Reliability is an important thing. And so she found this was really a great career path somebody with a research background. And she said a few things. One of the most interesting ones was she found that several aspects of her science training that were valuable. But also the fact, she said, you know, as scientists, we tend to find the unexplained interesting and not scary. And this is really valuable in my job. Because, so, we have a team that designs these things and we put them up on reliability testing, and of course you're going to get some failures. The typical response of the team is, oh no, big problem. This is terrible. We wanted to get this shipped. Now we've got some failures. What are we going to do? The scientist in her had a totally different approach. She thought, wow, this is interesting. This is not what we expected. I get to dig in there and learn something that we never learned before. And she actually found that as a great motivation for that job. And actually made her, her background perfect for that kind of career. And so that's still what she does now in medical devices. But the other thing she said is talking about the flexibility and some of those strengths that I listed earlier. You know, if you have a good science education, she said, the world is your oyster. You can do about anything. And that actually is pretty true, but I really like that that particular quote. So that's the first story. Second is a guy named Chris Meyer. So he's local. He actually got his PhD from CU Boulder. And in fact, he worked with the team under Carl Wieman that got the Nobel Prize back in 2001. He went on to postdoc with Dave Wineland at NIST, also doing atomic physics and spectroscopy, not so different than some of the stuff I worked with in gra- graduate school. But he also decided to go into industry, and he got his first job. He started working at Research Electro-Optics down in Boulder. And it wasn't even a year before he had decided he wanted to do something different. He had his own ideas, and so he decided to start a company called Precision Photonics. And the idea was they would make optics for a variety of different applications, but he was very interested in doing really challenging things, because he found that stimulated the scientist in him that had some big, hard problem to solve, and he would go work on it. He and his team would go work on it. But in this case, he liked the outcome that when somebody came to him with a really difficult spec, nobody else could meet on an optic, a polarization optic, or a lens, or some more sophisticated device, he loved that challenge of digging in there, figuring out how to get it done, but then actually delivering it to somebody who needed it. And that was a big part of why he ended up going out in the private sector. He said, you know, I want to make tangible things that people can touch and do all that. And so he actually started this company. He went back to NIST and started fishing for people that wanted to help him do this company. He found a guy named Kurt Vogel. I was actually speaking to Kurt a few months ago, and he was telling the story about, well, when we started this thing, Chris was out telling people we could do all these really challenging things, and we didn't have a lab, we didn't even have a garage. We were in his living room trying to do this whole thing. But he was just really excited by the ability to do hard things nobody else could do and actually solve them. So Precision Photonics has been really successful. They were actually bought by a company named IDEX and very successful. But here's the part of the story I like even better than that. He went on to found a company called Abiodiagnostics then in 2009. And Abiodiagnostics is a medical company. And one of the products they created is this little box that Chris is holding here. This is for doing assays. Now, I don't have a medical background, but the concept is this is used for diagnosing HIV and other co-infections, other infections somebody might have with HIV. So now we're talking about a pretty serious problem that he decided to go address. So the conventional approach at the time was to take a blood sample and send it off to a lab that's got $1 million equipment. A flow cytometer is what they would actually use to try and diagnose what people have. Well, here in the States, that probably works fairly well. A place like Africa that has, last I heard, is around 40 million people that are infected with HIV, that is not at all a practical solution. Many of them are out in rural areas. You can't take samples, ship them off to a city, and several weeks come back with results and expect to find a lot of them. That is not a good solution. So what he decided is he said, you know, photonics technology has gotten to the point where we can actually make small portable devices that will do this using lasers from DVD players and cell phone cameras and other things. There's a little cassette, a little plastic cassette that could be volume manufactured. Take a sample, put it in there. It tags it with a fluorescence dye, pop it in this machine, and you've got results in 10 minutes. And so you can take the people and say, okay, you need treatment. That's the only way you're going to address an epidemic like this. I thought this was a really great story, that he'd come from a research background, but he decided to go out and create this company to solve this really important problem. We all have really tough days at work where you get up and you think, I don't want to go in and face the problems, whatever I've got going today. But this story always reminds me, and when Chris gets up and goes in, no matter how hard it is, he knows exactly why he's doing that. There's a real motivator. I'm working on solving a really big problem. I don't know how it'll go, we're still working on it, but this is why I get up and go in and do what I do. So I really like that story, I think it's a great one. And he always talked about, so again, it comes down to solving problems. One of the most interesting things he said is solving a problem out in a company is about so much more than the technology. It's like 30 different axes that actually matter, you know, 30 different things beyond just the technology. As a scientist, he actually found that interesting. So these are all just other problems to solve, much the same way as I used to enjoy just learning science, learning all these other things, whether it's business or about FDA approval or human resources or all these other things, and he found that really engaging. And the quote that I like the most is he said, you know, creating things, starting a company like this and solving these problems, it's about shaping the world. And that's very cool. Yeah, that is very cool. That's really neat. I like that. So that's one of my favorite quotes from all the people I interviewed. So that's the second story. The third story, third scientist I want to tell you about is Peter Fisk. So Peter lives in California. He started out with a PhD from Stanford in geological and environmental sciences. And after he did that, he went on to a postdoc at Lawrence Livermore. Peter had always wanted to get into science policy, and that's what he first decided he would do. So after his postdoc, he got a White House fellow, and he actually worked at the Pentagon for a while. Pretty quickly after he got out there, though, he realized, okay, this isn't quite what I thought. Things move very slowly. He wanted a more dynamic environment. That really wasn't what he had in mind. So he came back, he moved back, and he got his job back at Lawrence Livermore. But then he started going to evening classes at Berkeley to get an MBA. And while he was doing that, he was fishing around for business ideas. He actually would give presentations and talking to the students who were doing research, much like yourselves, and saying, I want to start a company, I need great ideas. Does anybody have anything? And he was actually approached by eight different people, eight ideas that seemed like they had merit, and he worked through them all, and he found one that he thought was actually worth pursuing. And so they entered it in a business competition at Berkeley. They were having you apply with this business plan, and they actually won. And then he thought, oh crap, I have to quit my job. I wanted to start a company. Now here's this thing, we won, I might as well do it on that. And so he quit his job, and he started Raft Industries. I won't go into the details. This was basically a way for polishing silicon carbide mirrors. So silicon carbide is, I think it's the fourth hardest material on the planet. It's very good, high thermal stability. When I was at Ball Aerospace, we would actually design telescopes out of silicon carbide because you could have sunshine on it, and it was a great combination of high thermal conductivity but also low thermal expansion, and so it wouldn't distort much. But it's extremely hard, so how are you going to polish an aspheric mirror surface into this really hard material? Well, RAP stood for Reactive Atom Plasma Technology, I think was the T. And it was just a way of polishing fancy mirrors. That was his company. So he set off to take this idea. It wasn't his research problem, but it was somebody's. And they set off and started a company. Technically, they were very successful. They were not a financial success. So after about, it was around 8 years or so, they ended up selling off the company. But all those things he had learned in solving all these problems, learning all these new things that he had to learn, set him up to actually go right into a CEO position and his next job. And he joined Pax Water Technologies. So Pax, it's a little closer to what you guys do here. It's focused on technology for improving water quality, for cleaning it basically, of all kinds of different contaminants and things. And this company was on the brink of failure. He brought it back to be a successful company. All the things he'd learned starting a company here, using those scientist skills, the ability to do research and solve problems nobody ever had, he found very valuable and set him up for a great next step. Just recently, he actually, I had lunch with him in June when I was out in California. He resigned from CEO after they'd gotten to a successful point. He'd done what he wanted to there. He went back, and now he's back in research again. And he's directing the Water Energy Resilience Institute there at Berkeley Lab. So he's actually come back around, and after much of his career in industry, implementing solutions, he's back doing more research, coming up with more, generating more new knowledge. So the key message here is another great thing about a technical education that I know I didn't appreciate early on is it does give you a lot of flexibility in where you start your career. Doesn't say that's what you have to do your entire career. I think that's a really valuable thing. A lot of people want some flexibility, and Peter's story is a great one that illustrates you can do a lot of different things. But he has a couple of quotes that I thought were great. The first one is he said, you know, there's no better place to plumb the depths of your incompetence than at a startup. I thought that was really funny. And basically what he's saying is you learn a lot. And, you know, the value of being a scientist is great. And so he followed it up with, well, the great thing about a science education is you're constantly learning to solve problems that you've never seen before. And that's very useful as an entrepreneur. So really emphasizing that, you know, the same thing that many of you probably are exercising and learning as you work on your dissertation projects or whatever research you're doing, running into all these different problems that nobody's ever solved before and figuring out how do I get to a solution, that's actually really valuable. A lot of people don't get that training. You may not realize that being in a research environment, but that's very unique. It sets you up for that. Peter was, he was very adamant about that. This is a great thing about a science education. It sets you up for going out and solving your own big problems out in the world. So those are the three stories I wanted to talk about. And hopefully what that's done is made the case that scientists are great at implementing real world solutions. So I think that's, you know, that's a key thing there. But we have to remember the other thing is that, okay, but if you move out into the real world, it actually is a very different world. And if you go out into industry, into the private sector, and still function like you're in research, you're actually going to run into some challenges. So for the second half of the talk, I want to talk about, well, how is it different? So this is a summary of some of the lessons that I learned in that. I didn't really take me 20 years to figure it out, maybe, but in those first several years when I was transitioning from a research environment, I was out there in the private sector and industry, making things that people need, turning science into things people need, but learning, okay, here's some ways, really important ways that it's different. And if I can develop some new habits around that, I'll be more successful. So that's what I want to talk about in the second half of this. So I'll start with three critical differences and talk about a habit related to each one. So the first difference, really the research environment and academia in general is really about creating knowledge. And that's what it's about, creating and disseminating knowledge is what academia is about. Whereas industry, quite honestly, it's about creating profit. We know this because if you Google professor, it's amazing the number of pictures that you come up with of professors sitting in front of a bunch of books. It's absolutely true, but you know, I guess that's what that communicates. Is that it's really all about creating and disseminating knowledge. But the fact is, in industry, it's about profit. If you Google companies, or if you just pay attention to companies, it's all about earnings. Earnings reports are a big part of, that's what these are, covers from earnings reports. And I can tell you from working in the industry, that's the way it is. Any company has some investors. It may be the founder who used some of their own money. It could be angel or venture capital investors. Or if it's a public company, it's people who bought stock in the company. But every one of those, no matter how important the problem is you are trying to solve, it relies on money. And that happens by getting people to invest money so you can buy things and make product or make whatever you're doing to solve that problem. So you can't forget that it's about profit. Somebody's looking for a return. And honestly, even if you're working at a nonprofit, cash is still important. Even if they're not getting earning a profit per se, you still have to think about the return of your investment. There's still money that's required, and you have to make sure that you are spending it properly and investing it properly so that you can solve the problem and still pay the people who are working there and pay the rent and all those other things. So the key is, when you're in research, it's all about knowledge. Things can be fully justifiable just because they create new knowledge. In the company, they have to somehow create a profit. And so the first really important habit, scientists who move into industry and are successful, a big habit that they learn pretty quickly is to always be thinking about the work that you do and how it helps the bottom line of the company. That's a really important habit. It's something I ran into a lot of times. There was a really important point early in my career that really drove this home for me. I was at a company that made fiber amplifier systems with semiconductor lasers. And the group that I was in was going to split into two different groups. And one group was going to take this new technology called cladding pump fiber. But it was just really new technology, right? It's very cool. There were all kinds of intellectual property and design stuff that was going to happen. You know, how do you couple the pump light in and get the single mode light out and do all these things? I even have a couple of patents on that. It was very fun from a technology standpoint, fun to work with. But we weren't really sure what was going to be used for it. The other group was making erbium-doped fiber amplifiers. And if you're familiar with fiber communications, these are devices that were being used to carry internet traffic. And this was about 1999. Dot-com boom was taken off. Telecom hardware took off with it because everybody wanted to start buying their stuff online. So it wasn't as fun or a cool, sexy technology. It was more of a modular approach of buying off-the-shelf parts and putting them together to meet a specification. So from a technical standpoint, it didn't seem so fun. And I thought, well, I probably wanted to go into this other group. But I followed a manager I really respected who went into the group making the fiber amplifiers. It wasn't as cool from a technology standpoint, but you know what? They had customers. There was money involved. They had people that were paying for their stuff. So I followed him into that group, and that was absolutely one of the best decisions I ever made. Even though it wasn't playing with the cool technology, there was money involved. It was very clear what we were developing. It had paying customers, and that brought lots of attention from management. If we needed new equipment or we needed a new person, that was no problem because we were making money. Whereas the other group, they were working on cool things, but we actually would pilfer their people when we needed someone else, and because it wasn't really clear what would happen. That's some of the reality of industry. Always be thinking about your work and how it helps the company's bottom line, because in the end, that's what it comes down to. Second big difference. So in academia, it's really about a thorough understanding. Any of you that are working on your degrees, when you stand up to defend your thesis, you can be sure your committee will make sure that you have a complete understanding of whatever the problem is. In industry, it's really about results. And getting them fast and efficiently. Why is that? Well, in the end, results are what lead to profit. So it all comes back. Everything else will come back to that very first difference.
You have to think about the money part.
Results lead to profit. So, but this was a challenging thing for me too to learn. So I don't know if you were like me. When I was a student, I really liked seeing the full derivation of the problem. And frankly, this is encouraged, right? This is what you ought to do. I wanted to work out all the math and figure out how the thing worked, not just say, okay, I understand it, move on, but really fully understand it, understand how it related to all the other principles I knew, get that full understanding. And as a student, you have generally the luxury to do that. But out in industry, nobody wants to pay you to reinvent the wheel. It's a little bit different approach. Understanding is still important, but you have to find a way to not do too much of that and figure out when it's time to move on. It's really more about fast and efficient results. And so the habit associated with that, scientists who work in industry and are successful learn pretty quickly to figure out, okay, let me look at a project we have. What things are really going to matter, and what things aren't really going to matter much in the end. There's a bit of an art to that, but if you at least are always keeping that in mind, it's important. Sometimes you have to stop working on some of the problems that maybe just produce understanding but don't really get you to the result. It's a challenging habit, but it's an important one. Third difference. In academia, particularly in science, research, it's all about proving with enough data to be certain. Again, when you stand up to defend your thesis, your committee is going to want to make sure you have enough data to support whatever position you are trying to that you're putting forth. And that's what it's all about. And in general, in science and engineering, we assume there's a right answer, and you just need to do enough analysis or enough data to get to that point. But in industry, it's actually very different. Even in a technical industry, this can be challenging for those of us scientists and engineers to get used to, because the technology or the science or the engineering, the technical part of it, they may have a well-developed theory and be deterministic and provable and all of that, because it's mixed in with all these different business issues. Oftentimes, you can't get to the right answer. You don't really know what the right thing is going to be, what the right answer is, or the right path to follow. It might have something to do with marketing conditions, or what a customer wants, or dealing with people. Lots of things that make it very squishy. And so people who are successful are going to make good decisions without enough data. Why? Well, again, it's going to come back to profit. Decisions, the only way you lead to progress. It's the only way you move forward. Progress leads to results, and results lead to profit. It comes back to profit again. But I like to think of it a little bit like football as a good analogy. It's not always the best analogy in science. And I'm usually going out on a limb when I try and use any kind of sports analogy myself. But you know, football is a good example where data and analysis are important. Right? It's really important to watch videos of the other team to understand how they do plays. What they do. There's a lot of analysis involved in it. The fact is, you don't score until you pick a play and you go hike the ball and actually do it. And it may be the right answer, it may not. Everyone's got an opinion on it, but you have to make a decision to move forward and make progress. And it's the same in a company. The challenge for scientists and engineers working in industry is it can be easy to come from this background and continue that habit of thinking, if we just collect some more data, if we just do some more analysis, if we keep studying it, we'll get the right answer, and then we can move forward more confidently. And that is a bad habit. That ends up being an excuse for procrastination. And a lot of companies fail because people won't make decisions. It's not just the scientists and engineers, it's just we kind of have an excuse and habits that were developed during our training period that teach us to keep working on it and keep understanding more and collecting more data. But in a private sector environment, that can be fatal. You need to learn to make a decision without enough data. And so the third important habit, scientists and engineers who are successful in industry, learn to make decisions without all the data they like to have. That's a tough one, but that's probably the most important one. In fact, I like to talk about three types of jobs, certain basis set for breaking this down. There's a lot of ways you break it down, but the way I like to think of it, there are three different types of jobs that illustrate this. So the first type of job is you do what somebody tells you. A lot of jobs where the work output is fairly well defined and we just need somebody to do it, to implement it. And it's pretty straightforward. These are often paid hourly just because you just know what needs to be done, do it for a certain number of hours, and we get a certain amount of output. And that's worth a certain amount of money. The next level, though, is where there's a right answer, but we don't know it. And we need somebody who's smart enough or has the right training to go out and figure out what is that right answer and implement it. And of course, that's worth more. Science and engineering are fundamentally that type of a job. We assume somewhere there's a right answer. If it's science, if it's research, maybe there's we're trying to figure out how nature works. There is a right answer, we just need to find it. Or if it's engineering, there are design rules. The bridge or the building or the airplane or whatever, there's a correct design, and we need somebody with the right training and the right skill set to do it. And that, of course, is worth a lot more in terms of money. But the third type of job is where there really is no right answer. Or if in principle there's a right answer, we're not going to know it in any reasonable amount of time. But somebody has to decide what we're going to do and move forward. Well, this is leadership. This is what leadership is. And it really gets to that habit. So I like to encourage people, when you're thinking about where you want to take your career, it's easy coming out of a technical background to imagine, well, it's my job to find the right answer. But to function in private sector environment, you have to learn to make decisions when there is no right answer. And that is actually where the real value is, or the real risk. That's the other side of it. So you want to think about what kind of job you want. And if you really want to get into a leadership role, you have to be able to function in this area. That's actually where the most value is. So to recap these three habits, first habit, first habit for scientists in industry is they make sure their work always helps the bottom line, or at least they know how it does. Key to security, it's key to being productive, and frankly, it's key to having more fun. Because if you're making money in a company, that usually matters. It's actually easy for people to end up, especially in bigger companies, to be working on some pet project, and when times are great, that may work okay, but as soon as things get tough, management starts looking at, well, who's doing stuff that doesn't really contribute to the bottom line? And you can be at risk at that point. So this is the first habit. Second habit, they figure out what really matters and what won't matter in the end, in the search for getting to fast and efficient results. And the final habit, they learn to make decisions with limited data, without all the data they might like to have. These are challenging for those of us that start in a science and a research environment, but they're very important for functioning in industry. If you can make these part of your habits, you'll do well, and you will enjoy it. We're dealing with time. So that covers what I promised to tell you. There's actually more, and it looks like we have time to address it. So the last thing I wanted to talk about is some interesting resources for entrepreneurs. Again, if you want to consider doing that, or just for business in general. But if you actually really think you have a problem and you'd like to go out and start a company to actually solve that, it's more common these days, and there are more resources that can help you. Some local resources are what I'm talking about in this area that are actually pretty exciting. First is Innosphere. So Innosphere, it's a science and technology startup incubator, and it's actually located right here in Fort Collins. I just recently got involved with them. I've been working with the Innovation Center of the Rockies, which was down in Boulder for a long time. It was a similar kind of thing. And they really focus on taking technology out of the university and helping commercialize it, because that's a challenging thing. And so they provide a lot of resources to say, you got a great idea, maybe technology, it may be some sustainability problem, but to actually commercialize that, because it's about profit, there's a lot of other things you need. And so it connects you with advisors and funding and all these other things to help you do that. So I'm actually an advisor in this program, and it's really fun to work with starting companies and help them figure out how to actually be successful. And it's a very useful resource for anybody that says, you know, I've got something that I want to take out and actually try and solve a real problem. A second similar kind of accelerator is located down in Boulder, started by a couple of guys that graduated from CU 7-8 years ago, something like that. It used to be called the Unreasonable Institute, and now it's called Uncharted. It's similar. It's also an accelerator. This is for, yeah, I like that name. I like the logo, too, the little light bulb with wings. But this is specifically for social issues. That's why, especially for those of you in sustainability, might find a little bit more there. You know, they address things. They put together accelerator groups of advisors and mentors and investors and other things to help around specific causes. And so they might have one around food access or clean water or future cities, various things like that. And that's actually really pretty interesting. You can check out both of these, Innosphere.com and Uncharted.org. You'll find what they're about. Both very interesting and exciting resources that are available here. Another thing I want to talk about. So, you know, it can be talking a lot about profit, right? And that can often, for those of us that start in a research environment, that can come off feeling like kind of icky, right? Like, yeah, but there's a lot of greed and a lot of crap out there that I don't really want to deal with. And, you know, some of that is true. But to a great extent, that's just how things have to function out in the real world. But a really exciting new trend is B corporations, and B stands for benefit. But these are corporations that are certified to meet certain standards for social and environmental principles, transparency, and business operations and things like that. Essentially, it's a bunch of people saying, you know what, our company, yes, it's a for-profit company, we've got investors, they want a return, we'll do that. But you know what? It doesn't have to be about greed. It doesn't have to be about wrecking the environment. It doesn't have to be about screwing the little guy or anything else. We can actually do this in a way that is socially and environmentally acceptable. So they get that certification to do this. And there are actually some companies you recognize, a few local. New Belgium, that's a favorite. They're actually a B corporation. There are around 2,100 B corporations around the world now in 50 different countries. And Colorado has a pretty good effort. I think there's something on the order of 100. I think we just got our 100th B corporation sometime in the last few months. So I think this is a really exciting thing, this whole effort to be able to get back on track. But now we have the equipment in-house, so we have the flexibility to do more development on it than we could have otherwise when it was outside. You turned it into a success story. That sounds like something they care about. It sounds like industry experience, not directly. Incidentally, he started a job at a company called Clearing Displays in Silicon Valley just about 2 months ago. So apparently he had gotten some good stories and figured out how to get around that. You know, the fact is, they'll say you need industry experience, but everybody who's out there was in school, so clearly that's not true. You just have to know how to come across, not as an academic, but tell stories that help them see, first of all, you got valuable experience and skills, things you can do for them. It's not about what you've done, it's what you could do. And that you understand it. By telling those stories, you show not only do you have good skills, but you get it. You understand what industry's like. Long-winded answer, sorry. But it's that right there is a huge, important part of making that transition. Any other questions? Yeah?
So you've talked a lot about the way that scientific background can help prepare you for this new potential set of adventures. You have advice for those of us involved in education and mentoring of young early career scientists? Are there things we should be doing to help open these doors for them and help prepare them to go this direction if they want to?
Yes, absolutely. First is to bring people in who have experience in industry and talk to them. That's an excellent choice. I commend you for
this. Softball.
That is the best thing you can do. And, that was great, thanks. I'll pay you afterwards. So a lot of it actually is around the kinds of things that, in my last answer, anything you can do to help them understand it, and then to start to plan this way. So one of the things I recommend, for example, people running research projects, a lot of times in an academic environment, grad students, many schools, many places just kind of work on the problem until, as long as they need until it's done. People in industry look at that and go, it's exactly what we don't want, because that's not the fast and efficient results. So if instead advisors design programs where they actually have them do a schedule, actually plan out a schedule. This is always the most challenging part about industry. Oh, you're gonna do this, okay, when will it be done? Well, I don't know, I haven't done it yet. Oh, no, that doesn't work. When will you be done, And start to get them into thinking in terms of a schedule and intermediate milestones and trying to meet those, because that drives the efficiency, right? Well, look, we have to have this done next month. In industry, you do have to have it done next month. In academia, you say, well, that's fine, you can just graduate a little later. That's not the same kind of discipline. So they can start to run them like industry projects. Involve them in the budget. That can be useful to realize, to start to think about, there is money behind this, to the extent that there are expenses beyond just grad student hours. Those are some of the biggest things. But also then, well, internships are always great. I know that doesn't always work in a research environment where they're trying to get to their output, but just getting time in a company before you're actually out looking for a job can be really helpful. And then learning to describe, extent that anyone here in this environment can help them tell these stories about their background and understand what they need to sound like so that somebody in industry says, oh, that's very relevant, as opposed to, nah, you're just an academic or just a stereotypical PhD, right? That's not, those are the things that can really help. Yeah?
So graduate school involves a lot of time trade-offs. And advisors are really pushing us towards publishing, because that's mm-hmm. the currency if you want an academic job, and that's what grants care about, funding agencies. But in industry, does it matter whether you have 10 or 5 publications?
Not typically, no.
Or should we spend our time, if we're interested in a job like that, networking and doing internships and those other ideas you were talking about?
You need to do publications to help your advisor and help that whole thing. But if you're going out, the short answer is publications really don't matter. Now, there are areas in industry that operate a bit more like research. In hardware areas, physics engineering areas, that went away a long time ago with places like Bell Labs and Xerox that don't do much research. Pharma, biomedical, I think still tend to have some areas that are research, and I think they would argue back and disagree with me where things are still, it is more like a research environment. By and large, in industry, publications don't care. I can tell you nobody's ever cared how many papers I published. Unfortunately, that's just the way it is. What you want to do is parlay that into a strength in writing. Writing can be important, or arguing your point can be important, but not academic publications per se. Done a couple of publications since I was in industry, but these are much more like marketing kinds of documents, where you're actually talking about the new cool stuff you do. It's not at all, here's everything, science, you basically say, here's everything we did so you can fully replicate it. That, you don't do that in industry because that's IP, that's intellectual property. So, yeah, it's a different focus.
I guess building on that, do you have any recommendations for how to maintain a strong working relationship in academia as you look towards making those kinds of transitions?
Mm-hmm. Let's see, so to make, I'm not sure I understand. So want to do an industry.
Yeah, so if you're someone who has a boss or an advisor that needs you to publish because they have goals for their career, but you're wanting to invest more time to go a direction that you see your career going, how do you kind of maintain that balance?
Well, I think, when you're working for them, think of it, your advisor, your boss, you need to work for them, you need to do what they need to get that done. So I don't know that you necessarily need to change your time focus, because you still want to do what they need and you still want to get to that. I think of a lot of it as more how you interpret and how you talk about these things. So what I haven't really described yet, there really is a difference in what is looked for. It comes down to a CV versus a resume is one way to think of this. It's not that they have different facts or different things on them, not different experience, it's that a CV tends to be a list of all your accomplishments, because in an academic and research setting, that's what has value, what have you done? In industry, it's more, what could you do for us going forward? again, to simplify it, they don't care what you've done, they care what you're gonna do for them. And it's a different kind of thing. So it's just a way of interpreting what you've done. It's not so much you have to do different things, aside from, yeah, if you can start keeping a schedule and tracking, you know, but those fit with what you're doing anyway. It's just starting to look at it from an industry perspective. Gee, we do have to worry about money, and maybe the schedule is really important, and I should think about where have I influenced other people. So it's really more about what you pull out of it to tell stories about what you can do going forward, not just listing a bunch of accomplishments. Not so much different work. Does that make sense? Yeah.
What are the personality traits that you would think someone with a PhD would have that would draw them to industry versus academia?
That's a great, that's an excellent choice, or excellent question, because I do tend to find people seem to be geared more towards one or the other. And I'll generalize a bit, this isn't always true. But you know, the classic research environment, a tenure track position, yes, there's some work to get there, but it's a environment where you get a job and you can work on that for the rest of your career. There's a security, there's a constancy. Industry often is not that way. I've been in groups that have been shut down a few times, you know, lost a job. You may 1 month be working on something, 6 months later be working on a totally different product. There's a lot of variety. So people that seem to be drawn more to industry and like that aren't so much interested in a secure job as much as something that's really exciting, and maybe even a lot of change. They often really like the idea of making something tangible that's needed right now. That's actually where the title of the book came from, right? Things people need. Just about everybody that I interviewed in this, one of the questions I asked them is, why did you decide to move into industry? And almost inevitably they said, you know, research is great, it generates a lot of useful knowledge, but the time frame was so far out. I wanted to do something where I delivered something in 3 months, 6 months to somebody who needed it. Oh yeah, wow, great, this is great, thanks, and here's what we need next. They like that dynamic interaction. Many of them do like interacting with customers. That's something I really enjoyed. You know, I found myself very quickly, once I got out into the industry, I say, sticking my head out of the lab, to see, well, why exactly am I working on this, you know, and can I go talk to the customers and figure out where we go next and what we're doing, and I think those are some of the interests. You like to work with people. You know, there's not much of pulling yourself up in a lab all day and working on that. There's just not. It's a lot more working with a variety of people, not all technologists by any means. So those are some of the things that are very different. Yeah. Go ahead. I'll get to you.
How much ageism have you seen in industry?
Well, that's a great question. You mean me personally? Like I look old enough?
Not your time.
So actually, I have not experienced much of that at all. I do have some colleagues that are a little further along than I am that worry about it, but I haven't actually seen much of that. Doesn't mean that it isn't there. What am I thinking? There's a similar attitude that I do run into from some people, and I think this is kind of a killer at any time. It's that they tend to look more to the bullet points, whether it's early in their career, say, well, I have a PhD, I ought to be able to get this, or I have this experience, I ought to be able to get that, rather than relying on their ability to sell themselves. And I think the same is true further down the road. It's not inherently a problem to be older, it's what do you do with that? And if somehow in the way you present yourself, you come across as older, less energy, not creative, something like that, yeah, you're gonna have a problem. But if you're able to tell stories, it's back to stories again, and how you sell your background about you've got experience, you know, there's a lot of things you have that younger people do not, you'll be fine. So I think what we hear both at the front end, they say I'm overqualified or don't have any industry experience, I can't find a job, or at the far end, well, I'm too old, I can't get a job. I believe most of that is not really, they're not really taking responsibility for selling what they can do. That's how you get around that. Make sense? Yeah?
I was curious, like, if you've had, like, what you've seen, is there, like, any key differences between someone who has, like, a bachelor's versus a PhD in industry?
Sure, there certainly is a difference. That's a great question, because it kind of gets at the heart of people who are saying, should I go on and get a PhD or not, right? And it depends on the discipline. Usually people that have gone on to get a PhD, their best success is when they sell themselves into industry, either as an expert in some technology, sometimes they're able to move on into something that they develop, or just as a leader, and they go into leadership roles. Say, look, I ran a project, I solved all kinds of problems no one had solved before, and so they move into industry and have a lead role, whereas people with bachelor's have tended to, so scientists in particular, be more likely to just be working in the lab on a team at a lower level, because they just have not developed some of those skills to the extent that you do in graduate school. That's a lot of what I see. And they can still move up in time. Usually they will find the best success actually starting to learn more business and getting into maybe a sales or marketing role or management or something like that, where they're not really relying on the technical skills and some of these things, but taking it in a different direction.
All right, we're going to have to bring the session to a close. Join me in thanking David one more time.